I'm very pleased to welcome Margo Jefferson to discuss her poignant and disarmingly powerful memoir, Negroland, which is both a cultural and personal narrative of growing up in an upper-crust Black Chicago neighborhood that she refers to as Negroland, a place where residents were sheltered by a certain amount of privilege and plenty. She uses the dual lens of her own life and family and of the cultural influences of the time to provide a nuanced portrait of race and class in mid-century America. The book has received extraordinary reviews, including from Robin Givhan in the Washington Post, who called Jefferson a poetic and bracing memoirist, and Dwight Gardner in the New York Times called this book powerful and complicated. There's sinew and grace in the way she plays with memory, he wrote, dodging here and burning there like a photographer in a dark room. Margo Jefferson is a Pulitzer Prize-winning critic who has worked at both Newsweek and the New York Times and who now teaches writing at Columbia University. She will be in conversation this afternoon with Lisa Page, the director of the Creative Writing Program at George Washington University, and a writer whose work has appeared in such places as the Virginia Quarterly Review, Washington Post Book World, and the Chicago Tribune. Please help me welcome Margo Jefferson and Lisa Page.
Well, thank you. It's an honor to be at Politics and Prose. Let me say this into the microphone. It's an honor to be at Politics and Prose. Thank you very much, and I'm delighted to be talking with Lisa. I am going to read a little bit that I hope will set the various scenes, the screens and scenes, both culturally, historically, and personally. I'm a chronicler of Negroland, a participant observer, an elegist, dissenter and admirer, sometime expatriate, ongoing interlocutor. I call it Negroland because I still find Negro a word of wonders, glorious and terrible. A word for runaway slave posters and civil rights proclamations, for social constructs and street corner flaunts. A tonal language word whose meanings shift as setting and context shift. You know exactly what I mean. You know, we Negroes will not be defeated in our fight for civil rights. Those Negroes, you know, in the backyard are doing such and such and such. So you know what I mean. A tonal language word whose meaning shifts as setting and context shift, as history twists, lurches, advances, and stagnates, as capital letters appear to enhance its dignity, as other nomenclatures arise to challenge its primacy. I call it Negroland because Negro dominated our history for so long, because I lived with its meanings and intimations for so long, because they were essential to my first discoveries of what race meant, or as we now say, how race was constructed. For nearly 200 years, we in Negroland have called ourselves all manner of things, like the colored aristocracy, the colored elite, the colored 400, the 400, the blue vein society, the big families, the old settlers, the pioneers, Negro society, black society, the Negro, the black, the African-American, upper class or elite. I was born in 1947, and my generation, like its predecessors, was taught that since our achievements received little notice or credit from white America, we were not to discuss our faults, lapses, or uncertainties in public. Even now, I shy away from the word failings. Even the least of them would be turned against the race. Most white people made no room for the doctrine of human, all too human. Our imperfections were sub or provisionally human. For my generation, the motto was still achievement, invulnerability, comportment. Part of me dreads revealing anything in these pages except our drive to excellence. But I dread the constricted expression that comes from that. And we're prone to being touchy, self-righteously smug and snobbish. So let me begin in a quiet, clinical way. I was born into the Chicago branch of Negroland. My father was a doctor, a pediatrician, and for some years head of pediatrics at Provident, the nation's oldest black hospital. My mother was a social worker who left her job when she married And throughout my childhood was a full-time wife, mother, and social life. But where did they come from? And what clubs and organizations did they join to seal their membership in this world? And then I give a little vita of myself. Ancestors, fathers, fraternities, mothers, sororities, national clubs, etc. And I say, local clubs, schools, camps will be named as we go along. Skin color and hair will be described, evaluated too, to an exhausting point in this book, along with other racialized physical traits. Questions inevitably arise. How does one, how do you, how do I parse class, race, family, and temperament? How many kinds of deprivation are there? What is the compass of privilege? What has maimed and made me? Here are some of the group's founding categories, the oppositions and distinctions they came to live by. Northerner, Southerner, house slave, field hand, free black, slave black, free mulatto. Skilled worker, unskilled worker, free or slave, owns property, owns none. Reads and writes fluently, reads in little but does not write. Reads and writes a little, neither reads nor writes. Descends from African and Indian royalty. Descends from African obscurities. Descends from upper class whites. Descends from lower class whites. Descends from no whites at all. White Americans have always known how to develop aristocracies from local resources, however scant. British grocers arrive on the Mayflower and become founding fathers. German laborers immigrate to Chicago and become slaughterhouse kings. Women of equally modest origins marry these men or their rivals or their betters and become social arbiters. We did the same. Colored society was originally a mélange. All right, now I'll just read a couple few paragraphs from the beginning, which are more individual, and then we will proceed, Lisa and I. I was taught to avoid showing off. I was taught to distinguish myself through presentation, not declaration, to excel through deeds and manners, not showing off. But isn't all memoir a form of showing off? In my Negroland childhood, this was a perilous business. Negroland is my name for a small region of Negro America where residents were sheltered by a certain amount of privilege and plenty. Children in Negroland were warned that few Negroes enjoyed privilege or plenty and that most whites would be glad to see them returned to indigence, deference, and subservience. Children there were taught that most other Negroes ought to be emulating us when too many of them, out of envy or ignorance, went on behaving in ways that encouraged racial prejudice. Too many Negroes, it was said, showed off the wrong things. Loud voices, brash and garish ways, gift for popular music and dance, for sports rather than the humanities and sciences. Most white people were on the lookout, we were told, for what they called our basic racial traits. But most white people were also on the lookout for a too bold display by us of their kind of accomplishments, their privilege and plenty, what they considered their racial traits. You were never to act undignified in their presence, but neither were you to act flamboyant. Showing off was permitted, even encouraged, only if the result reflected well on your family, their friends, and your collective ancestors.
Thank you.
And now we have to reflect well.
So you talk about how Negroland is the third race. Would you break that down?
I will. I took this, many friends, their words and our conversations are threaded through this book. And I took that from the very astute observation of a friend of mine, who's one of the people the book's dedicated to, Christine Carter. And we were talking one day about how we saw ourselves, our world. And she said, we thought actually of ourselves as the third race. And then we started to break it down. Not between, positioned in terms of our role in society, our class, that clash between caste and class, positioned between all white people, though the only white people we really wanted to deal with were educated, cultivated, at least upper middle class white people, but we still, you know, had to be wary of the others and positioned between the larger group of less privileged Negroes. I will keep using that word to be time specific. So therefore, it wasn't so much we were racial mulattoes, though there were, we all now know, so many blacks had all kinds of racial mixtures, but we were culturally in this liminal space between how white people viewed themselves and were viewed, and how black people, many of them, lived and were also viewed. And it was kind of secret, as well as, you know, it felt like almost a secret society.
Yes.
Yeah. And I end that passage actually by saying, yes, this did mean in so many ways that we aspired for the qualities of whiteness, which you could say meant many of us wanted. Privileges and qualities, wanted to be white. But as I end that section, I say, you know, white people wanted to be white just as much as we did, given how they had defined white. The difference was they could pass.
So you describe your childhood with your sister, Denise, in Chicago, and you talk about magazines in your parents' house, art, music. And you have a particular scene where you see the copy of Ebony, and it has Eleanor Roosevelt and Mary McLeod Bethune on it.
Yes.
Would you talk about that?
Yes. You know, every month, Ebony in those days was huge. It was one of those big, big, big magazines, as actually were Vogue and Harper's Bazaar. So every month, this Ebony would arrive with this strange combination of everyday naturalness, because the point was to show, you know, our achievements and our easy, comfortable fit into prosperous American society, but it was also filled with racial uplift stories and racial struggle stories and these strange headlines like, you know, British woman takes care of 5 Negro orphans, you know, is baseball too black? Yeah. So it had this Ripley's Believe It or Not quality oftentimes. And as a child, you would just be pondering these things. There was this one issue I remember with Eleanor Roosevelt and Mary McLeod Bethune. Mary McLeod Bethune, as many of you know, was the founder of the National Council of Negro Women, and had founded a college in Florida. She had been one of the few women and the only black woman to work in Roosevelt's cabinet. So she was a great leader. Eleanor Roosevelt was many things other than the wife of Franklin Roosevelt. Progressive person and a kind of leader in her own right, better on civil rights, more progressive than her husband. But here the two of them were, and I read the article when I was doing the book, but the point to me was, and here is where gender is so much a part of the book, you know, they were late middle-aged, they looked so gloomy and worthy, and dutiful and unglamorous, and everything I didn't want to be, that kind of female uplift and progress felt so burdensome compared to, now remember, I'm growing up in the 50s, compared to what was supposed to be our destiny. We were supposed to, of course, do very well in school and succeed, et cetera, but that in no way meant you were not supposed to marry well, you know, have children and succeed. Really starting with puberty. Don't be sluttish or fast, but succeed as a cute, winning girl. I just could not put these two things together. And part of me just said, okay, leave them aside till they're old enough for me to handle, which when the women's movement came along, they were.
You also compare to movie stars, Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge, and what they meant.
Well, you know, the best way to sum this up, we had so few people in those days that every time an entertainer or an athlete or a scholar, scholars, let's not pretend got that as much attention, but every time they did anything, you know, we were beside ourselves. Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Closer.
Oh, can you all hear me? Okay. But I have to be sure. Okay. You know, every time, you know, if they were on TV, we would huddle around the TV. We would talk. You know, it's not mythic that people danced in the streets the night Joe Louis, you know, won the fight. But Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge were the two famous. Pre-Eartha Kitt and pre-Diane Carroll, they were the two icons of Negro beauty and glamour. Yes, here we are, and stardom. And when my sister, who was 3 years older than I was, about, I think, eight maybe, she turned to my mother and she said, "Who do I look more like, Lena Horne or Dorothy Dandridge?" And there, you know, and there we were, constantly parsing ourselves according to them. Another story that I tell in the book is of being at arts camp when I am 14. And at this point, Diane Carroll has arrived. It's Parents Weekend, I think. And a little girl, clearly the younger sister of a camper, probably about 9 or 10, white, came up to me. Now, I'm in camp uniform. I'm in knickers and a little blue shirt. And she says, "Excuse me, but are you currently starring in a show on Broadway?" The show was No Strings. Now, how did I answer? Of course I had to say no, because I was not mad, but I was so thrilled by that, that I treated her response as if I were a star, in fact, saying, "Well, no, actually, not that movie wasn't mine." I said, "Why, no," I said graciously, "you must mean Diane Carroll. Isn't she lovely?" I said, "She's very, very good, but I'm an interlocking right now." And then I pulled myself up and walked off rather grandly. So, you know, that was that sense of scarcity and extraordinary value and fantasy and identification that we as little Negro girls had with these stars, these women stars, even as I have, you know, in that way that we were always living double and triple lives, we were all busy identifying as well, as I'm sure you were Audrey Hepburn or Doris Day. But the investment shot up so acutely because an edge of reality entered whenever a black woman appeared.
And your comparison, going back to the Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge, that was so interesting to me, was Dorothy Dandridge comes off as wanton, and you write about how we as black women were expected to be wanton. Would you
well,
talk
we
about
were,
that?
This was the horror and the terror and a genuine historical legacy all through, really starting in the 19th century, you know, as, you know, the first groups of, you know, activist black women and men, but let's focus on women, really, started, you know, agitating and talking about rights for blacks and black women. One of the first things these women had to do was defend black women against this extraordinary body of propaganda and material. And it's all, they're licentious, you know, they're incapable. Now, again, this is the 19th century, where definitions for what women should be are acute. They are incapable of being virtuous wives, good mothers, of being the center of families, you know, and all of this is Victorian propaganda about womanhood, the family, upper middle class society. You know, they are degraded. So, you know, we had to take on this whole burden and prove in every way, from, you know, our diction, our table manners, you know, to a certain kind of prudishness, you know, to marrying well and making sure we, you know, knew how to keep a good home and raised our children well, we kept having to work against this reputation. And it was still very much that specter, that demon, was still very much operating when we were brought up as little black girls. And add on to that the general, dictates of propriety imposed particularly on upper middle class girls, and it was a nightmare. Now, the distinctions that people like my mother, who was very witty, actually, and could be very scathing, the distinctions they made between Lena Horne and Dorothy Dandridge were this. Lena Horne, however sexy, and she was very sexy, always had a certain hauteur, a certain icy distance, which she came to write about herself. Dorothy Dandridge was more voluptuous in her manner and seductive and more yielding, it seemed we would say. And one night she appeared. She also played slaves. She played a slave in Tamango, though she refused to play the Asian slave in The King and I. That would have been a better deal than a slave in Tamango. But one night she appeared on, I believe it was the Ed Sullivan Show, and she sang some, now I think it's a pretty ordinary little song, though, you know, a kind of trashy femme song. She sings, "Mercy, little Mr. Percy, stop picking on me." And my mother rolled her eyes, in essence, and said, "Mercy, Mr. Percy? Why doesn't she sing it standing on an auction block?" And, you know, it was also rumored. And what I'm trying to give you is a sense of how cultural scripts and mythologies and, you know, constructions of behavior and gossip are all intermingling. The other problem was that Lena Horne had married a white man, but the story was he wanted to marry her and she turned him down. And she had had a black husband first. Dorothy Dandridge, everybody knew, kept trying to marry white men like Otto Preminger, thereby, as we saw it, making a fool of herself, making herself look not just possibly wanton, but craven and needy. And we were supposed to be creatures of pride at all times.
You also talk about beauty and how you negotiate it, you and your sister. And you talk very specifically about hair grade, about noses,
absolutely,
lips,
yes,
skin color. Would you talk about that now?
Well, I'm sure I'm not the only person in the room who grew up remembering this. But, you know, again, it's as if we were scrutinizing. We were under surveillance by ourselves, dictated to by really Nordic, Anglo-Saxon notions of beauty. Mediterranean and Latin were fine, but they were a little lower in the scale initially. I think you all remember it wasn't until the 70s that full lips really started appearing, on models. So we would calculate. And this was, again, something we took from our parents, our grandparents, and, you know, we knew perfectly well what the skin order was. The whiter you were, the paler you were, the better. In addition to that, you know, you needed a thin nose, slender lips. It was a point of a little pride in my family that my grandmother's lips were so thin that she had to widen them with lipstick. And I'm using myself and my family as an example, but, it, you know, to some degree, particularly, even probably worse in the South, a little bit better in the North, to some degree, this was going on in every household. And again, you could see it in Ebony and Jet, the constant ads for skin lighteners and brighteners and so many kinds of hair straighteners, you know, one could not begin to name them. So skin color, nose grades, how full or thick, it used to be said, your lips were, and, you know, all of somebody could look Nordic, that was great. Somebody else had a kind of Jane Russell, Mediterranean, Mexican, though it turns out Jane Russell is Jewish, but we used to think Marlon Brando had black blood. So you could calculate all of those things. Dead straight hair, as we used to say, was the best, but lustrous curls were good, you know. It's just when you got to those words that I still hate to say because they were so painful then. Kinky and especially nappy, you know.
Yes.
That's when you had to feel kind of lousy and work very, very hard to keep your hair in order.
And the whole community was working very hard.
Yes.
At trying to maintain these levels of beauty, both male and female.
Yes, beauty and presentation. Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Men had a whole set of routines from, conks, which were considered a little street, to stocking caps, which men would wear in the house to make sure that their hair went into neat little waves and ridges and didn't look too bushy. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
So these were pressures on you in terms of beauty, yeah. In terms of femininity, and
presentation.
Yes.
And decorum.
Yes.
As my friend Nancy Giss, the word she always uses is comportment.
Yes.
Ironically, but definitely, yes.
But you also write about a little girl who lived at the end of your street who came from another part of the community. Would you talk about, what's Betty?
Betty Ann.
Betty
was
Ann.
Her name. This is true in so many cities. It was very true in Chicago, which was a very segregated city. And
still is.
Yeah, exactly. Still is. But even more so. The lines in cities between the houses, apartment buildings where people have established themselves as, securely, properly bourgeois, and the ones who are considered working class. The lines can be half a block, around a corner, whatever. My neighborhood had become all black, having once been largely white, and the block kind of divided in half. And my sister and I became very intrigued by a girl named Betty Ann at the end of the block, whom our parents did not approve of, because she wore red nail polish and,
She was loud.
She was loud, but we loved her loudness, and she played double dutch. She did double dutch fabulously. And we were, there was already, and I mean this seriously, because it would emerge in the 60s, this pull between bourgeois culture and black vernacular, folk culture, street culture. Many of us didn't do things like play double dutch well. We really didn't. And we didn't dance as suavely at parties. This was cultural. This has nothing to do with biology. This is culture. So we wanted to play with Betty Ann. We tried to, and Betty Ann was really not interested in us. Because I'm sure she was perfectly aware via her parents of my parents and a certain kind of distance they kept. We weren't good at double dutch. You get back where you can. Betty Ann was able to get back at us by, one particular day when I really was jumping badly. She and her friends just fell out, oh, please. And so my sister and I pulled ourselves together, mortified, and walked down to our end of the block. That was their revenge. My parents' revenge was to say, okay, I get they're jealous of you. The neighborhood is changing, and we're going to have to move. So this is the book is filled with these, incidents, scenes that are particular and personal, but that always, which is so much the way we lived, always signify lots of other social and emotional and cultural forces, that are again have to do with class, can have to do with race, but class within race, color even within the same race, and gender.
And you write about your life and about the privilege you had in terms of going to Interlochen and the University of Chicago Lab School, et cetera. But you also write about your own despair, growing up and dealing with these issues, and your personal suffering. And you do so in such a brave way. such a choice to talk to include that in this memoir?
Well, you know, it was personal. We have our temperaments, we have our reactions in the same family. You know, two people can respond quite differently. But I felt in a certain way, you know, a memoir is personal, so I didn't want to lie. But I also felt in a certain way that it was, you know, my struggles with, you know, certain kinds of depression, melancholia. As I began to talk more to other people, among good friends, it did begin to seem to me that this was one not so unusual reaction, a kind of combination of exhaustion mm-hmm. and a need for, you know, relief and release, a reaction to this constant, you know, coming from inside and totally coming from outside. You know, white society, that big superstructure, and then within, the demands placed on us to be the best of the best, to represent always, to be perfect. You know, that sometimes depression was the, first of all, it was really like a kind of PTSD.
Yes, PTSD.
You know, please. And also a form of, I think, of strange and not very useful, but a form of rebellion. You know, I'm not perfect. I need a rest. I want privacy. Leave me alone.
You know?
I am very angry, but yeah. I can't express it.
But you talk about depression being a white girl's option.
Well, that was the other thing. You know, one of with women particularly, every group of women has certain, you know, tropes that work for them. And they tend to work against them, but basically the working trope for black women was we are strong, we are indomitable, and for black people that would then merge with we are too powerful to give in to depression and collapse. To do so, to acknowledge it, would be to admit that racism has won. White women, certainly, again, at the more privileged bourgeois level, you know, there's this legacy of, I can be, you know, I'm fragile. Society can be too much for me. Broken blossom. I can collapse. And, you know, it's not to say that Sylvia Plath had a good life, but, you know, not only was art, but myth, you know, great myth was made out of this. And I really, at a certain point, began to envy that. You know, I thought, okay, give me this avenue of expression. And I'm hardly the first person to do it. In a way, this is what Intisaki was writing about with For Colored Girls. Her earlier ancestors would include the novelist Nella Larsen and the playwright Adrienne Kennedy. But, you know, I'm interested in the extent to which black women and women of color are allowed to acknowledge vulnerability, periods of collapse, and then recoup. And we're going, you know, we're complicated, we're multifaceted. And it does not help anyone to be told constantly, you must be strong, you must always look over your shoulder, you know, you must, certain things that are absolutely human emotionally are not allowed to you because they're a mark of failure. It's of no use.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. Well, on that note, I think we're going to open this up to the public. We have two microphones for you to come up with questions. For Margo Jefferson.
Hello, Margo. Do you know who this is? Louise Levathes. I was in your class.
Oh, my God. Yes, we were at Columbia together. It's Kiki.
Kiki.
Hi.
I know that you were in a special kind of Negroland, both at Columbia and then later at the New York Times and Newsweek. Could you talk about that a little bit? I think you've scooted around some of the issues professionally, but it just sort of in general, I mean, it's sort of a ghetto within a ghetto. You're in the woman's ghetto, and then further, you're in a black ghetto professionally. And would you just talk about, I don't think we did really at school for some reason.
Not across lines. I think the women's movement had started then. So some of us really talked about that. Some the black students talked about race, but it was not, you know, not something we eager little journalism students were really digging into. I think the, you know, the years that we were at Columbia, 70 to 71, were the years that, because of the uprisings slash riots, this was the first time, starting in the late 60s, that white newspapers and radio stations, magazines, were hiring black reporters en masse. Always, you know, let's call it special interest reporting with a vengeance. Always, you know, so you could hit the ghetto. On a business level, blacks tended to be hired for the human resources departments, not across the board, but I am talking about this certain ghetto that Louise referred to. And that was, you know, you could absolutely see that while I was at Columbia. And the professors were trying in some ways to grapple with all these changing facts and politics, but not necessarily grappling all that well. When I entered the professional world, and my first full-time job was at Newsweek, the women had just signed a memorandum of understanding, which meant they wouldn't sue if some of them, just a few, got promoted from being secretaries. There were lots of secretaries with masters and PhDs, to writers, editors, etc. Blacks, of whom there were obviously fewer, had talked about bringing a suit. Everyone was being careful. I got a lot of jokes about, oh, two for the price of one in those days. And I was hired as a reviewer, as an arts writer, which was unusual. I was both the first person of color and the first woman to be in the arts section at Newsweek. I walked a double line. I wanted it to be part of my mandate to make sure that people of color, you know, not just American blacks, but, you know, the literary works of of Asians, of Native Americans, and of all kinds of women got reviewed. And most of them were going to get reviewed by me. I also knew that I did not want to become the go-to person only for those books. I was unwise, but also, you know, all this, I'd had a lot of training and a lot of things. I knew a lot of stuff. And why shouldn't I write about that along with my peers? So I was, I had, once again, you know, I was moving in this liminal space between two worlds. And that has really remained true, sometimes three and sometimes four worlds, through my work at the Times, my, you know, work as a journalist in general. I am always walking those paths. I have come personally to appreciate it because it gives me a lot of negotiating space. I still absolutely, you know, I resent the, you know, the political necessities that impose certain presumptions or obligations on one for what you ought to say, when you ought to say it, you know, when your race is useful, or your gender is useful, and when suddenly it's not. So.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It added a lot that you quoted an entire letter from your mother, and it allowed her to speak directly the way memoirs don't always. Well, thanks for that, and I wonder, was there any more material or topics that you didn't make it into the final version of the book, and are you working on anything else now?
You know, I'm thinking about what to do next, and I honestly don't know what it'll be. Friends who've written books have told me, and I've seen it, that when you jump immediately into the next subject, it's like the rebound lover, you know? Oh my God, why didn't I wait a little longer? I wasn't really interested, okay? So I'm thinking about that. I really wanted this. Some people have asked me, you were much more discreet, you know, well, why didn't you take it all the way up through your professional life? And I really wanted, that's why I called it Negroland. I really wanted to show this making, this social, cultural, and personal construction at a very charged, Lisa and I were talking about this, political and cultural time. I wanted to show myself in that context. So, you know, maybe it's a volume one in that way, but I don't know. I knew that this was the basic shape, you know, with those pieces also that are from the 70s, 80s, and 90s. I don't know what'll happen next.
Thanks. Hi.
Hi.
I have so many questions. I'm going to try to pick the one that's the least incoherent. At least I hope it is. You know, the 20th century, everybody keeps saying, was a century of change, but it always surprises me how much certain parts of the world are impervious to change, and particularly the upper crust tends to do a very good job of not changing in response to demands that are political and economic demands. And I was just wondering if you know, you talk about the pain and the sheer hard work that you had to go through.
Yes.
I mean, it's a job in itself, and having to be responsible as being the poster child for an entire class of people, a self-identified
and
class
yeah,
of people.
Yeah, a classic. Yes, exactly.
A class, yes. Right. Yes, yeah. And yeah. And I was wondering, this world of which you speak, if you were to enter it now as a five-year-old child, I mean, has there been any give that we can think about in terms of either the extent of it or the politics of it or the...
Do you mean the white world, the
no,
black
I mean,
world, or both?
I mean because the Negroland, the family, the world, the street,
Negroland.
For example. I mean, you grew up without the internet, for example. Not that it solves everything, but I'm just wondering whether you must have seen and documented shifts and change perhaps in approach or organization or mobility or something. And I was wondering...
You can't think about changes in Negroland, which would no longer be called
right.
Negroland, without measuring and comparing them to changes in the larger society. You just can't. So that's a very hard question to answer.
But it'd be the sort of hard work that you had to go through.
I think a lot of that hard work
remains.
Its focus might be very different. Gentility does not exist in the same way for any girl as it used to. Certain constructions that were the backbone of racial prejudice have been chipped at. They mm-hmm. haven't disappeared, mm-hmm. but they've been chipped away at. So in those ways, there's more room. But I think there are, you know, and also this question of, in my day, what dominated was respectability politics. You know, yes, there were some, you know, genuinely progressive leftist people in that world, but, you know, it was even Du Bois in the early 20th century, before he became a Marxist, had embraced through the Talented Tenth mm-hmm. this notion of respectability yeah. politics will carry the day for black people. You know, citizens of my world are much more savvy about that than they used to be. You know, their politics are, many of them have far more varied and challenging senses of political struggle, right. political involvement, you know, and that's, again, the world has changed, whether it's Black Lives Matter, Occupy Wall Street, you know.
Of course.
You know, this Obama as a useful symbol, whatever one thinks of his politics. So,
thank you very much.
Okay.
Somebody
over here. Okay. Yeah. Oh,
hi. Thank you so much. I've so enjoyed this, and I'm really excited to read the book.
Thank
a lot
you.
Of what you say resonates. My question, and maybe you've answered it because I think you're talking about possibly doing a book eventually as a follow-up. My own mother was born in 1945 in Tennessee.
Okay.
And she went to Fisk.
Yes.
Oh, Fisk University, you know,
the
back
stronghold.
Then, now. But anyway, the reason I say that is because I'm curious as to how you reconciled growing up in Negroland with the changes that were happening in the 60s. My mother's deceased, but I was so fortunate to find some letters that she had written to her mother in the South when she had married my father, who had joined the Air Force, and he mm-hmm. was stationed in Germany.
Okay.
And what was so poignant, she never spoke of it because, just like you said, a lot of things we don't speak of. But she's writing to my grandmother in Tennessee about her confusion because she's married my father. They're now living in Germany. She's this educated black woman who's gone to Fisk University. But for the first time, she's seeing mixed race couples. She's seeing U.S. soldiers, black soldiers, who are married to white German women. Mm-hmm. And in one particular letter, she's saying, we've been invited to have dinner, and I'm not sure if we should go. Now, of course, over the years, that's laughable, because before my mother died, she'd become such a different person. But you could tell it was a struggle.
And it was the world of the army, which is a universe unto itself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But prior to that, there was an episode that my grandparents would laugh about when she came home with an afro. And mind you, my mother was as fair as you, and her hair was very straight. I took after my father.
Well, mine was not.
Okay.
Okay. As you can see.
Well, my grandfather told her, don't you ever come home with your hair like that again. And so just all these episodes, she struggled, and I'm wondering, how did you reckon? She's deceased, so I can't ask
my,
that
my, you know, all of my friends, Lisa and I were talking about this too, and we basically all hit, give or take a few years, we hit high school around 1960, okay? Civil rights at its absolute peak, and the anti-war movement and
that's
the new left was starting, okay? We hit college in 1964. Everything is getting much more militant. Civil rights is turning into black power in 1965 and 66. Now, I'm in college and school in New England, but all over the country, there are demonstrations. There are black power demonstrations. There are, lectures by everyone from the Deacons for Defense and Justice, to James Farmer and James Forman. And they're at white colleges and they're at black colleges. It's part of the cultural and social life. And it's mixing up with all sorts of things like, the first year I got to college, I remember the day the first girl on my dorm floor got the birth control pill, so there's free love, there's free sex, there are all these kinds of music. We were, were we on the front lines? I'm not trying to melodramatize myself, but we were all part of it, the rituals, the signs and symbols, the excitement. I feel extraordinary. And was it hard sometimes? Yes, because that kind of extreme change. Did we argue with our parents? Yes. Did my mother say about my afro, if a fly found its way in there, it would break its little wings trying to get out? Yes, she did. But and did we start trading information about how to handle your afro the way we used to about how to handle your straightened hair? But it was exhilarating, and it was all of us in it together.
We have time for two more questions.
Okay.
Hi.
Hello.
You were great at the book festival. Caught you on C-SPAN.
Oh, thank you.
How do you identify now? And I'm curious as to what kind of reactions you may have gotten from your peers and from other people for being so truthful about your experiences. And I want to applaud you for doing that and for telling your own story. And I mentioned you yesterday at a luncheon. I'm a Howard University woman, twice, so I don't need to say more than that. And now that I look at you, you do kind of favor Lena Horne.
Naughty. You're very naughty. Now, when you say, how do I identify now, do you mean what name I call myself?
No, but do you identify by culturally? How do you identify culturally or racially?
I still use black, which was my generation. Mm-hmm. That was mm-hmm. our breakthrough word, and I'm comfortable with it. I picked Negro, for these very particular reasons of history
that.
And respect. But I'm still all of the names, Negro, black, African American, mm-hmm. woman from a particular world, class, time, period. I don't think that imposes any limits on me except limits I might impose on myself.
Right. Absolutely.
You know? Is that what you meant?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. I applaud you for telling your own story and not giving it to someone else to tell.
Well, you know, we are such multifaceted people as blacks. And one of the ways that that discrimination and oppression work is to flatten out not just economic, you know, or social distinctions between people. They flatten out the particulars, psychological, cultural. They flatten out the reading of all of us as individuals as well as groups. So, you know, that's what I'm after as a writer. And the more of these different kinds of stories we get, you know, just look now. There's Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Yes.
There's my book. There's Hilton Alls. There's Tracy K. Smith. There's Elizabeth Alexander. We are all peers and colleagues, and we respect each other. We are so different as writers, as temperaments, you know, and that is exactly, that's what makes it a good time. That makes it a good time. You know, it's what we always expect in music and other art forms. We've got to have it in literature, nonfiction, fiction, and poetry.
Well, we thank you for telling our story as well.
Thank you.
And there are many of us sitting here that can identify
a
with
good. Well,
you know,
I'm glad. It's
an
story. It's been a story also that's been pushed a little over to the side. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you. My pleasure.
Got one more.
Okay.
Thank you for being here. I haven't read your book yet. It's on my list. But sorry.
Give it to someone for Christmas.
Yes, but I think you just touched on it just now. But I'm wondering if, in your recollection during the 60s and the 70s, if there was a time or issues where the black upper class and the more black radical movements, such as Black Panthers, were in lockstep on certain issues that affected the goals and aspirations of blacks in Chicago?
Well, certainly there were black, I'm thinking of my a friend and I were talking about Black Scholar magazine. You know, there were certainly black intellectuals and black educators who were working, who were more aligned with black radicals. You know, I can't say I remember that there were, you know, this was a big movement, but there were black radical leftist scholars and artists, you know, who were very much some of the musicians from that big great jazz group that George Lewis and Richard Muhal Abrams, all of them, some of those musicians were from the black bourgeoisie, and they created this whole, you know, kind of in its way socialist aesthetic, you know, for black avant-garde music. You know, there were law groups, you know, that were working in an impressive way with black prisoners, you know, black radicals. But that's as much as I can tell you. It's, you know, was it a huge movement? I can't say that it was, but it existed.
Thank you.
And with that said, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for coming.